So the question is, what is your favorite subject?
See, I don't think love is a subject. I think love is a way of being in the world. So that if I have a subject, it would be reflection on love.
I love this question. How do we change the campus climate to achieve faculty equity, diversity that reflects our diverse student body? Thank you. Whoever wrote this question.
That's a very important question, though, because with the magnificent focus now on equity in the form of making sure that people who find themselves on the margin and trying to gain access, not just to a mainstream, but to change the mainstream. The fundamental mission of any college is the fallible quest for truth, the acquisition of knowledge, and the transformation of persons. So that when they graduate, they're different than what they were before they entered school. And the citizens and human beings. And so any faculty has to raise the question, what does the fallible quest for truth look like in our curriculum? Are we being honest in what we are studying? Is it broad enough? Is it deep enough? What is the breadth? What is the scope? What is the depth of what we're studying? And this is a challenge for every institution of higher learning. And too oftentimes, institutes of higher learning have slices and don't have the broader conversation. You've got to have the broader conversation. And you got to make sure, of course, that you have the high quality scholars from a variety of different perspectives, different colors, different genders, different sexual orientations, different religious and non-religious traditions.
I can make up questions if, okay. Thank you. What advice do you have for young Black student leaders seeking to collectively unite our Afro students?
One, I just want to congratulate the younger generation for that awakening that I talked about. Persons of my generation, many of us were on fire in the 1960s and 70s, but we oftentimes get fatigued. And once you run out of gas and get fatigued, and the younger generation, all they see is the fatigue rather than what you were like 30 years ago. The young folk in Ferguson, Charlotte, LA, Compton, Seattle, all around the country, in many ways the world, hungry, thirsty for the real thing, truth, beauty, goodness. And what that requires is a recovery of the figures in the past who can serve as sources of inspiration to you. You see, it's like when I first time I met Brother Anthony Hamilton, I loved that brother. He's a great artist. And we had long discussions about the great artists of the past, for him to be great. So it is for leaders. You say, somebody tell me, well, I'm a young Black leader. Tell me your relation to Stokely Carmichael. Tell me your relation to Diane Nash. What is your relation to Fannie Lou Hamer and Ella Baker? Well, Brother Wes, I know Stokely, but I don't really know the other ones. No, then you got some work to do on your quest for greatness. It's like somebody playing the piano. Well, oh, I'm a classical piano. What is your relation to Vladimir Horowitz? Well, I don't really know of Vladimir. You got some work to do. Because they set the standard. And any attempt to be great means you have to be on intimate terms of folk who already achieved the thing you haven't even achieved yet. What went into them? How did they do it? You got your own voice, but you got to learn how they did it. So young Black leaders, you want to be on intimate terms with the great Black leaders of the past. Not to imitate. All imitation is suicide. Emulation, the sign of an adolescent mind, to be inspired. That's why Brother Kendrick had to spend some time with Snoop, didn't he? Because he understood He can't beat Kendrick Lamar without Biggie and Tupac and Snoop and the others and Dre and the others, because they already achieved the level. He's just a young brother trying to take off. But he got something to say. Y'all know where he got that first name from, right? Kendrick. That genius from Birmingham, Alabama, sang falsetto for the Temptations, called Eddie Kendrick. His mama named him after Eddie Kendrick. So he already had a jump start in life in terms of his music, because Eddie Kendrick's was also a towering genius behind the David Ruffins and Otis Williams and others in the Temptations. So young folk, be deeply rooted in the best of your history. That's what Sankofa is all about. You refuse to look forward until you are connected with the best of those who came before, so you are equipped to be great in the future in your own way.
As someone who is Palestinian, what do you think the next step is for justice?
Well, I mean, good God Almighty, I want to salute all my precious Palestinian brothers and sisters, but I think it's just a matter of being human. I think just to be a human being means we all ought to be sensitive to anybody who's catching hell, any people under occupation. It could be Kashmir, it could be any occupation, but because U.S. dollars are so tied to Israeli occupation, Americans do have a special kind of concern about that. And we're living in a very, very downbeat moment because both candidates have not said one positive word about the vicious treatment of our precious Palestinians under occupation. So we have to continue movements outside of the electoral system. We don't have candidates other than Sister Jill Stein of the Green Party, who's my dear sister and my dear candidate. She's the only one telling the truth about it. And the sad thing is that any of our precious Jewish brothers and sisters think that there can be security for Israelis. So Israelis must have security. They deserve security, but come out of a people of 2,000 years who's been trashed in vicious ways. But you can never have security predicated on the occupation of a people. Sooner or later, chickens come home to roost. You can't do it. United States tried to do it with slavery. United States tried to do it with Jim Crow and Jane Crow. Sooner or later, truth crushed the earth will rise again. And there's no way that any group of human beings will live the deplorable conditions under the Israeli occupation without various kinds of ugly resistance. I think the killing of an innocent person, no matter who they are, is a crime against humanity. But right now, with the U.S. government and the Democratic Party and Obama and Clinton, of course, Trump, good God of mine, we don't have any expectations of that, brother, whatsoever. But the ones who pose and posture as if they're so serious. I mean, the thing about Trump is he just knows he's narcissistic, xenophobic, gangster, thuggish. That's just who he is, and he just lets you know. There's a certain honesty about that, even though he's dangerous. But a lot of times it's the folk that act as if they're so concerned and then turn around and promote policy. That's part of my problem with Hillary. You see, we marched against Hillary in 1994 when she called our young brothers super predators. I say, no, those are my brothers. They wrong, they gangsters. Yes, they ought to be punished if they did that, but they're not super predators. They're not irredeemable. People thought Malcolm Little was irredeemable until Elijah Muhammad loved him into a new way of being in the world. He became Malcolm X. Nobody's irredeemable at all. And of course, with Sister Hillary, we could tell her. I said, well, you called them super predators, that these people are irredeemable. When you supported Goldwater in 1964, does that make you irredeemable? No, you can change, Hillary. You did change. Goldwater was a gangster too when it came to Jim Crow and Jane Crow, and Martin Luther King Jr. said he's the most dangerous politician in the nation. And Hillary's out there with pamphlets for him. Now, that doesn't mean she's the same person now. I'm not saying that. People are not irredeemable. You see? And so when they use that kind of language, you got to say, oh, let's just tell the truth across the board. And this is true in our own lives. I know everybody in this room has done something that would make you look as if you were irredeemable at that moment. But somebody loved you through it. Somebody believed in you. So you were able to grow, mature, and develop. That's the truth of what it is to be human across the board. That's got to apply to everybody across the board. I'm sorry to go on so long.
Oh, that's fine. Can I let you? Are you okay? Nearly 20% of Long Beach City College students are homeless, and this homelessness threatens the student success. What is the community college and our responsibility to these students?
I was just talking to Brother Mark Ridley Thomas about this because they've been dealing with this issue of homelessness on the Board of Supervisors. We were using different internet sites, including my own, for this. I think there has to be a moral state of emergency called. Homelessness has to be a major priority, bringing together persons with resources. Business people, trade union, churches, mosques, synagogues, students, and say, we are going to eliminate this plight in this particular region and state. In the same way, when anytime we go to war, all of a sudden we mobilize all of our resources, we make it a priority, everybody begins to talk about it in such a way that you have to make some contribution to eliminate it. Now, I think we ought to do this with poverty across the board. And of course, we tried to do this, you know, many times with poverty tours in the last 10 years and so on. And that's just a matter of trying to be true to the legacy of Marion Wright Edelman, Children Defense Fund, Child Poverty Focus, and of course Martin Luther King Jr., who was trying to eliminate poverty when they shot him down like a dog in Memphis. So that the elimination of poverty goes hand in hand with the elimination of homelessness, but making homelessness something to do away with across the board, and it's non-negotiable. It's got to go. That's the kind of attitude and orientation we have to have. And it has to be done multiracial, multi-class, multi-religious, and so on. But it's 20% of the students.
That's what it says.
Wow. So that means you're doing homework in your cars and things. Lord have mercy, sister. Good God Almighty. Reading Shakespeare in the back seat. And that's a crime against humanity. It's a crime against humanity. My dear sister, let me give me a hug though. Sister, come. Is there a special program at the college to deal with this kind of thing?
The program does have services. The problem is that being that this is so systemic, it's a break because they can only do so much, and it's numbers. If you help one and then that person falls back in the same problem, then it's like they've exhausted the moment with you. So you go on to the next people because they also need help, which makes sense. But as you see the hiccup there, because you still technically get a little bit left behind. And then the resources that you do have available that will help you outside of the school that they resource you to, it's such an abundant amount of people. I mean, it is all age categories. It is a tsunami of individuals that are trying to rebuild their lives, and the institutions can only do so much. And then when you deal with the bureaucratic background of it, you yourself are having to do all the legwork for those people to help yourself. So it's a snowball effect. And then you're looked at as, well, you know, we've done so much, and they do have to go on to the next person because I wouldn't want to rob that other person of their opportunity. But it's a fault. There's a break, and there's no line that brings the drop with those individuals. There's nothing to recover back from. All you're told is just get a job and maybe to think about school a little bit later. But no, you're not taking away my opportunity and my dream. This is my decision, not yours.
Thank you so much, my dear sister. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So, oh yeah, good God Almighty. No, but she, I mean, she's so eloquent that I just want to. But you know, when you think about it, though, that the way so many, I don't know what the dynamic here is at this college, though. I know when I was running track, though, you all had some magnificent athletes coming out of here. And, you know, they have all this big money for sports, all this money for athletics, and people willing to give and so forth. How come we can't have somebody giving money for this so that even that hiccup can be eliminated? Because you got people on fire for education, and all they want is just a chance. But I'm sure the leaders and presidents and so forth are wrestling with this, because I don't really know what the exact institutional constraints are of the leadership, but I'm sure there's got to be some kind of state of emergency declared when you have so many folk who are hungry to learn and have to end up sleeping in cars in order to read Shakespeare, Toni Morrison, or study chemistry. It's just not right.
Maybe we can use that amazing $2.5 million in equity something to come up with something, right? We can do that. Many of my students believe that morality is subjective and that nothing is truly just or unjust. What would you like to say to them?
No, I think that that might sound fancy in a philosophy seminar. But if you ask that same person, if somebody attacked their mama, raped a sister, that's just subjective and neither right nor wrong. Now, if you think that something that catastrophic is neither right nor wrong, then you are a spectator moving through life rather than a participant who's full of feeling and passion and sensitivity with others who have loved and been concerned with you. That's the challenge, you see. I mean, the old Greeks used to raise the question, can the skeptic live his or her skepticism? You see. Well, life is just a series of appearances. There's no serious rights or wrong that have any weight and so forth. Oh, does that mean then that the killing of a mosquito on the wall has the same weight as the crushing of your precious child? Well, I wouldn't go that far. Then quit playing philosophical games then.
Thank you so much.
I mean, I don't want to be hard on mosquitoes, but I know people want to be.
What books do you recommend reading that would inspire us?
Ooh. Oh, no, yeah, you want to read James Baldwin's The Fire next time. You read that book once a year, that deep love ethic that I was talking about, that's at work. Now, Toni Morrison's Beloved is a tough novel. It's gonna really hurt. I would read Chekhov's short stories, because Chekhov is connected to a blues sensibility in a profound way. I would read Michelle Alexander's The New Jim Crow for a contemporary analysis. I'd read essays of Adolph Reed Jr. He's worth reading. Somebody help me. What other good books people should read? Yes. Huh? Oh, Coates' book. Yeah, but between me and the other, between me, what is it called? Between me and the something world, yeah. The absolute. No, that's certainly worth reading. I'd read Baldwin before you read Coates, though. James, Richard Wright, Black Boy. Yeah, Richard Wright, definitely. Where do we go from here? Martin Luther King Jr. Yes, indeed, indeed. Invisible Man, Ralph Ellison. But it's not just reading, though. I think we have to learn how to more closely read music. You see, music is not just a form of entertainment. It cultivates the soul. It teaches you something about life. You see. Anything older than 1980? No, you could see Kendrick Lamar at the Grammys with the chains. The tradition came through him. Gil Scott-Heron. Nina Simone sang the song that she wrote, To Be Young, Gifted, and Black. Then listen to Donny Hathaway's version of it, To Be Young, Gifted, and Black. You got to listen to both of them at the same time. And then at the end, listen to the greatest of them all in the 1960s. The genius from the west side of Chicago who dropped out of high school in the eighth grade, wrote a song called Gypsy Woman when he was 14, and I'm So Proud when he was 15 and a half. His name was Curtis Mayfield. Listen to Curtis. Listen to Superfly, Freddie's Dead. Listen to Superfly, Super. Then listen to Claudine with Gladys Knight, with Curtis writing all the music. Make Yours a Happy Home. I'm so glad I got my own, so glad that I can see. My life is a natural high. I think man can't put no thing on me. Show is funky, show is funky. I ain't no junkie, I ain't no junkie. That's Curtis. He's the great prophetic one of that particular moment, but there's so many others, the Jerry Butlers and the others who all around him. So when we talk about text, we want to talk about literary text, but we want to talk about sonic text, text and sound in that regard, because it's very important. And then, of course, I haven't talked about hip-hop. I mean, you know, Chuck D and KRS-One, and we can go on and on. Oh, and these days you got Emol Technique, Jaziri X, go on and on.
I think maybe you already answered this question. What is your favorite album? Music album, but if you want to elaborate.
Yeah, it depends on which day of the week it is. You know, it's probably What's Going On spoke the closest to the depths of my heart and soul. Love Supreme is so profound, I've yet to even come to terms with its depth, and I've heard it about 10,000 times, but Coltrane is just so deep. But Marvin Gaye, probably because I come out of rhythm and blues context, is the album that cut deepest to me, but Stevie's written some albums that cut very deep. Stevie Wonder too.
I have a recommendation for a book, Black Prophetic Fire. Maybe you can start from that.
Read that one last.
Superman or Batman? That's the question. Superman.
Lord have mercy. No, this is Long Beach City College. You all something else. I tell you that. If I had to choose between Superman or Batman, I would choose Jesus.
Yes.
That's unfair, that one.
How could we fight gentrification that is destroying Black and Latino neighborhoods?
Well, yeah, we've been trying to fight it for a long time in New York, though. These are very powerful forces. These are big business forces. You got real estate forces. You got real estate entrepreneurs and so on. I mean, what you want to try to do is first let it be known so there can be public conversations about what the nature of the processes are. Put a spotlight on them, make them transparent, you see. Public colloquiums, newspapers, talk about it in churches and so forth. What is going on? Let people know. And find out where the people are going. We find out we're in New York. You're pushing folk out of Brooklyn, they end up way up in Bridgeport, Connecticut. Because people are unconcerned about where the poor people go. They're just gone. They're not here no more. Well, where are they? Well, I don't know. They're just not around no more. Johnson just left. Where is Johnson? I don't know whatever happened to Johnson. But find out what happened. Find out where all of them are. Keep track of them. Maybe you ought to have policies that if it's going to take place, there's certain kinds of support for folk who are pushed out. That's part of the larger conversation in a democracy that puts a premium on dynamics that ought to be publicly talked about and known, rather than keeping it hidden all the time. You see, look at the TPP, it's the exact same thing, isn't it? Corporate gentrification of the whole planet. 500 people have been involved in the last decade in conversations. How many poor people? Zero. How many trade unionists? Zero. How many everyday people? Zero. Who's making the decision? Secret agreements of those at the very top from Wall Street and corporations. They didn't want to fast track it through Congress, so Congress can't even find out. Brother President Obama, how come you want to move this thing so quick, man? Let the people know what's going on. This is NAFTA on steroids. Let the people know. Well, I just think that you have to trust us. No. We trusted you on a whole lot of things. No. Let the people know. We decide for ourselves. We have our own intelligence and imagination. We can choose. We can judge. Anytime somebody keeping something on the down low that's going to reshape your life fundamentally, it's time for you to wake up. Time for you to wake up.
The questions are pretty similar, so I will ask this. I think this represents a couple other questions here. Has there ever been an instance where your theological education has come into conflict with your message of unity and equality?
You know, I've never been formally educated in theology. My dear brother went to the Great Union Theological Seminary. I never went to a seminary. I went to college and then I got a PhD in philosophy. My education, when it comes to religion, was centered at the West family and in Shiloh Baptist Church. And I read some great theologians, the Tillichs and the Niebuhrs and the James Cones and the Beverly Harrisons and others. But I already had an experiential base that I brought to the conversation. Now, once you engage in that conversation, there's always a number of different tensions that are generated. That's what it is to be part of a high-quality conversation. But the challenge is not to eliminate the tensions, but to live a life of integrity in the midst of the tensions. The tensions must not go away. They will follow you to your grave. There's no such thing as a tensionless life, or a tensionless theology, or a tensionless philosophy, or a tensionless music. Any attempt to be true, it means you're going to carry some tensions with you. And the question is, what do you do with them? Brother Martin used to say that peace is not the absence of tension. It's the presence of justice. And justice always has tension in it. But any justice that's only justice soon degenerates into something less than justice. That's Reinhold Niebuhr, more man and moral society. And the only thing that can rescue justice, deepen justice, is love. And love is just as what love looks like in public. Full attention. Just like tenderness is what love feels like in private. But that's full attention too. And if you think you got a relationship that is free of tension, I would say it's about over. Because the opposite of love is not hate. The opposite of love is what? Indifference. Indifference. If there's no tension, then people are indifferent towards you. And if your loved one is indifferent towards you, you better turn on some Isaac Hayes. You need more tension. Love and tension. Love, feel tension.
What impact do you feel having culturally relevant pedagogy or pedagogy has on student learning for people of color?
I think it's true for anybody. I think it's true for anybody, everybody, that any serious study of the past, and the past is always a little different, very alien to our present, but it impacts the present. And therefore, any attempt to understand the past is a kind of history of the present, too. The two are intertwined. So, and it's especially true for folk who feel as if the mainstream curriculum doesn't speak to them. You see. But any serious wrestling of the past is tied in some way to an intervention into the present, trying to make the future a little bit different and you hope a little bit better.
In order to be great, quote unquote, and make a change in our world, what is the first thought we should have in the morning? What words should we say to ourselves?
See, I don't think we ought to have the same thought every morning. You know, I mean, each day is different. And you come with different thoughts for different days, you know. I'm wrestling now with, you know, the death of my family member. And what I wake up tomorrow morning is not going to be the same as when I woke up 6 months ago when I was at the Apollo the night before, having a wonderful time. So it's different thoughts for different mornings. I just think the one constant we ought to have is love of self and love of neighbor. It ought to be a fundamental commitment to trying to be honest and have some integrity. And then connect it with our friends, because you can't do it by yourself. You can't do it as an isolated self. You have to have links, ties with other people who are concerned about you. And if you can't find persons who are alive, then just bounce it off against the voices of the dead. Du Bois's Souls of Black Folk. You just read that and you say, my God, Du Bois is speaking to me. Well, yeah, he's been dead since 1963, but he is speaking to you. That's how it is. Lorraine Hansberry, she's speaking to me. Raising in the Sun, Walter. She's been dead for over almost 50 years. So the voices of the dead can also generate thoughts for you in the morning. So that, but it's going to be different. I think it's going to be different. But the most important thing is to have this general orientation of your whole life and your whole self, which is love-centered. I think love really is underrated in terms of its force, and is over-talked about because it's usually viewed in such a superficial way. But actually, it love and suffering are the two constants. And you think about it. Look at Hamlet. It's probably the greatest philosophical figure when it comes to literary works in the modern West. We were just talking about this with Sister Nirvana, your wonderful daughter. And Hamlet suffers from the inability to love. Now, Dostoevsky defines hell in Brothers Karamazov as those who suffer from the inability to love. That's what living hell is. Go through your whole life and you can't cultivate the capacity to love. So every moment's lust, every moment's control, every moment's conquest. So when Otis Redding sings, "Try a Little Tenderness," you don't know what he's talking about. But when somebody else sing, "Say my name, say my name, say my name," you know exactly what they're talking about. And if you get locked into lust, get locked into control and domination as a way of life, then you don't no longer have what is required to cultivate vulnerability, intimacy, risk, reciprocity, giving and receiving. That's what love is. You see? And so most people go through life more and more just stimulation and titillation. And what does that lead toward? Self-medication. What does it lead toward? A joyless quest for pleasure. You get all the pleasure in the world, insatiable, can't wait for the next moment of pleasure, but there's no joy. That's hell. That's hell, you see. And it seems to me that, you know, it's the truth-telling required, because that's what so much of our culture is today. That's one of the big differences between young people growing up today as opposed to when I was coming along. When Donny Hathaway sang about the ghetto, he's talking about love. Folk talk about the hood. They're not talking about love. They're talking about survival of the slickest. Leroy Hudson and Donny Hathaway wrote that when he was 22 and a half. Founded by Curtis Mayfield, brought him to Chicago. He talking about the ghetto. Y'all know the ghetto, right? By Donny Hathaway and Leroy Hudson. You know that song. Listen to it tonight. Listen to the notes. Listen to the lyrics. What goes into that? 22 years old from St. Louis, he's generating that level of maturity. Then try to find an analog in the present context. It's difficult because there's not enough love being cultivated there, you see. And again, it's not in any way an attempt to put young people down. I salute young people because I didn't have to deal with those kind of circumstances. I grew up with all this love coming at me. I wasn't even worthy of it. I didn't even deserve it. It just happened. I was saturated with it. That's not true for most young people these days. So I salute them. They got more strength than me. But you still got to come to terms with cultivating the love in your own way. And it's love of self, of others, of truth, of beauty, of goodness. And as I said before, if you're religious the way I am, it's of the holy too, a love of God.
You are the manifestation of everything you say. You are love, you're justice, you're peace, you're everything. And I salute you and I love you and you're my hero and I know you're the hero of so many here.
I just want to salute you all. Stay strong in what you're doing. Thanks for coming out today, and let's stay fortified. Stay fortified. Bless you, bless you, bless you, bless you.
So give a round of applause. Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
And can we have Dr. West? Dr. West, I think Dwayne is going to take you to the room, but can Miss Rostin, you wanted to. So thank you so much, everybody. But please, if you need, you want your books to be signed, here's Ken Rostin. Thank you. Give a round of applause to Miss Rostin. She worked so hard for us. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay, everybody, that concludes Dr. West's presentation. If you would like to stay and have your book signed, please remain seated. We will be doing that in a orderly fashion. However, if you have somewhere to be or you cannot stay, the program is over and we ask you to exit from the back. Thank you so much, so much for coming. Thank you.